What they don't tell you is, when you go onto the ship, you get seasick, and when you leave the ship, you get land sick, and everything is turning around a little bit, like if you were on a ship, a permanent earthquake or something like that. So I'm working ever since the last 20 years in large-scale software projects. When I started, it was a tiny large-scale project. It was about 30 developers in the mid-90s, running for about 12 years, the whole project. I was not there 12 years. Then the project became bigger. It was about 100 developers running for about 10 years until it was canceled because there was no outcome. And now for the last 15 years, I'm working in a project with about 250 developers. To give you an impression, what I'm talking about is about 50,000 C# files, 16,000 configuration files where you can configure your application and do everything. In fact, you can't do everything because if you do anything wrong, you just don't get anything anymore. It just doesn't work. Yeah, several build scripts and a bunch of C, C++, JavaScript, Visual Basic, HTML, and so on files. So this is what I'm dealing with every day. And what caused all this number of files and configuration files is, I think, is the architecture. So in a project like this, there are architects who do nothing but architecture. Maybe they have coded when they were young, but they don't code anymore ever since the last 15 years or so. And one original citation was, our architecture has to last for the next 30 years. So we design our architecture to last for 30 years. That was in the beginning of this millennium. It was the time before all this multi-core stuff evolved. It was just we're getting more megahertz and gigahertz, and everything will just run faster. And so 10 years ago, there was a big boom because the processors didn't perform faster, not the single cores. They just got more cores, and the software was not ready for this. And in fact, it still isn't ready because it's such a large amount of code, you cannot refactor this to be multi-threading. They try, but it doesn't work. Me and my colleagues, we're talking every day, and we just get mad about all this mess, because if you want to do anything, it takes you ages. Just to create a dialogue with a few buttons on a text field, I did it just half a year ago. It took me 1 week to get this dialogue into the system. It's a little bit. It's my son. You can't see him. There's a principle that's called SOLID. Single responsibility, open in, and so on. Liskov. This is an architecture thing that you can implement, but as with everything, you can exaggerate this, and that's what they did. Also, this divide et impera, divide and rule, so to split up your application into smaller parts, and these parts will then do only their own thing, and so on. This works fine if you find an end to split up. But if you split it in two tiny parts, it just misbehaves, because nobody can oversee how they are connected anymore. And you find yourself in kind of unnecessary abstractions. So you have got base classes and base classes of base classes and so on. You have got an interface flood. There's an interface for everything, an interface for factories and so on, just to get the possibility to extend something or to exchange something which is never done. So I would say 90% or 95% of all the interfaces have just one implementation. They don't even have test stubs or something that will be exchanged then to make it testable, because the architecture doesn't foresee unit testing. So we start to implement unit tests now, but it's very hard because everything is so interwoven, you cannot easily exchange parts of it, because they all require some kind of inter-process communication and so on. You have to mock everything, and it's very hard to do so. And the most annoying thing is these extension points. So in the code, you don't see anything. You don't even see the classes. You don't have any tools to help you, like ReSharper, to find any implementation, because this is done by the XML configuration files. So there's a set of configuration files which define which class will implement which thing, and you could exchange it at customer side or anywhere, which nobody does, because then it doesn't work anymore. You have to exchange everything. Yeah, but it's it will last for the next 30 years, I think, that nobody is going to exchange anything. Mission accomplished, yeah. You know. And what you get is something like this hourglass. An hourglass looks very easy. Just put sand into some kind of filter and wait until it disappears, and then you measure the time. On the other hand, there's a clock with all these gears and so on. This sounds, looks complicated. But the difference between those two is you can almost always calculate what the right clock does. You count the number of, I don't know the name, teeth of the gear. And see how they rotate and so on, and there's a spring, and it's all mathematically be describable. It can be easily be repaired, and so on. This is maybe complicated, but it's not complex. The people are doing this since the last 500 years. The hourglass is not complicated, but it's complex. It's like having 50,000 files of code and being interwoven with a third of configuration files. Yeah? Everything might be very small and tiny, like a grain of sand, but you cannot calculate how they behave in masses. You can just see and let it flood through and say, oh, it checks the time, but if one little grain of sand misbehaves, you cannot calculate this. Over-configuration, yeah, that's one of the most annoying things we deal with. It's meant to exchange something, to be to be flexible in somehow. But if you exaggerate this, then it gets very annoying. It's almost not debuggable. You have no tooling to help you. You can write your own tools, yeah, but this takes almost as long as the other developing the real software, or even longer. And the problem is, once you got the tools, then the configuration stuff might evolve, then you have to adjust the tools to cope with this. And you cannot debug anything. Yeah? You start the application, you have to search for log files or something. You cannot see on the debugger why this class is now instantiated or not. What they also do is they invent new frameworks for database access or for multiprocessoring, even for multithreading. They have their own frameworks to just to abstract this from what's well-tested and well-provided by some larger company. They always think, "Yeah, oh, well, that's not exactly what we need. We need something else. We might exchange the underlying database somehow someday. So we just have an abstraction between and a layer with an own framework and so on." Has anybody of you written an application where the database has been exchanged 1 or 2 years later? Yeah? And it works fine? And did you have an abstraction between before? Yeah? Ah, oh, there. Congratulations. Yeah. I've never seen such a project. Yeah. Yeah, you try to reinvent the wheel sometimes, or make it even better. The problem with creating your own frameworks, your own application servers and so on is you don't get any help from the outside. If you use something like JBoss or some other application server, you can just take a look at Stack Overflow and somebody already had this problem. And if not, you just ask something and you easily get an answer if your question was not too dumb. And it's not the business. So there's a little story I've read when I prepared this talk about a hammer. But a carpenter wants to buy a hammer, and then he goes to the store and says, "Oh, we don't sell hammers. We have this kind of and that kind and that kind and that kind of hammers, not just hammers. What hammer do you want?" "Yeah, I want a, don't know, sledgehammer or something." "Ah, the problem is we don't have this kind of hammer anymore because the people don't want special hammers. They want a universal hammer." "Yeah, then sell me the universal hammer." "Ah, we don't sell this universal hammer anymore because it's not good in every detail. So what we now sell is, or what we used to sell is, we sell a factory where you can create hammers. Yeah? And you just have to feed it with some resources and employees and so on, and then you get the hammers you want." "Yeah, can I buy this factory?" "No, we don't sell this factory anymore because the people just don't want to create every hammer. They just want to create a special set of hammers, so we now sell a factory that creates a factory that creates hammers." "Yeah, then I want to buy this factory." "No, the problem is that the people don't only want hammers, they want to have saws and meters and gauges and so on. So what you actually get is we sell a factory, a universal tool-creating factory, where you can create a factory that creates a factory where you can create exactly the hammer that you want. And this is something that frameworks do for you. So you just have to do some configuration, and then you get exactly what you want, and nothing more, nothing less. And there, that's something that maybe some people are already have coped with. It's exaggerated, but yeah, it's annoying. So now, from the abstraction a little bit more to the details, multi-threading. Multi-threading is a very good thing to split the execution code up to multiple cores. But sometimes, so I'm reading on Stack Overflow and trying to help some people. And sometimes I get the idea that multi-threading, especially also in Swift with or this Grand Central Dispatch job, is way too easy to use. So the people just write the code, have some multi-threading, and then they wonder why the text field is not updated. And then you write for the thousandth time that you have to do this on the main thread and not an arbitrary thread. Also, what's coming up in Swift soon will be something like futures and promises, where you return a value that will be calculated in some future. Not now, but in the future. And then when it's finished, you can get the real value from this stuff. There are some implementations in Swift already on GitHub, but I think it will make it to the language itself soon. It's also something that's very easy to use and easy to be misused. Yeah? Because multi-threading is kind of evil. You have to think of many things before you use multi-threading. So you won't give your little boy child or girl child a chainsaw in its hand because it can do anything. You start with a knife, maybe a sharp knife, where it can hurt itself, but it won't be such a big disaster like with a chainsaw. Yeah? When I started programming, it was the C and the C++ agents, where multithreading was very hard to understand. You have to think of everything and so on. And yeah, you would not easily do multithreading if you can avoid it. So there you get an idea what happens on behind. With all this future promises stuff, I think sometimes it's too easy for the people to do it. And they write very nice to see stuff that doesn't run in the long term. And it's also hard to test. In C#, there's something that's called LINQ, Language Integrated Query, where instead of writing for loops and so on, you can write some SQL-like code to analyze your data and to create something new out of it. Yeah, from a set, join another set where something equals, where something contains a name and so on, and then we create a new object that contains data from this query, let's say. And you can also, with LINQ, you can return collections or enumerations that will be executed on demand. So you return a kind of list or an enumeration, and only at the moment when you access elements from it, they will be calculated. And this also works with LINQ for SQL and LINQ for entities, where you've got database connections, database reads here. So you distribute all your enumeration through the whole application, and you don't know when they will be executed. And if you do this in a large project, then you get database logs where you don't expect them. And you don't can handle them. And even worse, this typically happens at customer side because the customer has different data than you have, so it behaves a little bit different. Then there are some easy constructs to use in LINQ, like any, to check if there is any object in some list and then do anything. We had this, we had an iteration about medical images with a LINQ statement, and it should check if there was any data in a list. And this iteration took 30 seconds to run, and it produced, exchanged this any call with a count call. So we checked if the count was zero. It's almost the same as any does. The drawback of count is it counts everything first. So it may take longer. One would think it takes longer. But if in this special situation, we had the case that it was almost always empty. And what any does is it creates a new enumeration that's empty and then throws it away, disposes it. So the most runtime of this 30 seconds was just the garbage collector cleaning up all the enumerators that he created temporarily just to check if it was empty. And if you look at Stack Overflow, everybody says, don't use count, use any. And I tell you, check first if any is good, because if any always returns zero, because almost every time your collection is empty, you should maybe use count. Then there are some tricks, operator overloading customer operators. You should also take care if when using those operators. Here, in the example, there's this tilde greater than, which will execute the left-hand side in a background thread, and the right-hand side, the return value, will be handed to the right-hand block, which then will be executed in the main thread. There's a link. That's with threading, which is nice to read, but if you don't know this syntax, if you're new in the project, then you don't know what happens here. If you have a problem here, nobody can help you on Stack Overflow. If you have to do something to debug, maybe you don't find it at the right place. So you have to take care not to do too much tricks in your code just to save a little bit of coding. Then there was something like, so in Objective-C, some people did this method swizzling, associated objects to just do some funny stuff, let's say. This when Swift evolved, this works with several classes, with several others not. So I remember a question on Stack Overflow where somebody wanted to associate something with an index path, which you get when you do some cell operations on table views. And they associated objects with this index path. And in Swift, it doesn't work anymore because the index path is a struct, and the struct doesn't have this, it cannot associate any object anymore. Yeah, but you don't see it. The code still works. It returns false, but nobody checks the return value here. You would explicitly use NS index path in Swift, then it works, but nobody knows how long it works. So if your code relies on tricks like these, like method switching associated objects, you might get problems in the future if you're too sophisticated. Sometimes it's even better to use simple algorithms. I think everybody can understand what this does. It does a for loop about every element and just multiplies it with 2. And now the second for loop just adds them up. There's also a nice way. Now, typically today, nowadays, we would do it this way, like some mapping and reduce. Yeah? It sounds easier, it's a lot less to write, but this simple example is easy to read. But if you get something like the link statement a few slides before, if it gets too complicated, I think it's much harder to read this. Yeah? This is a bad example because, in fact, the right example is easier. Yeah? But it's just to demonstrate is if the right thing gets more complicated, it's easier to write a simple, unsophisticated for loop, which is nested or somewhere, where you can set breakpoints at the correct point and so on. We can step through. Maybe if you can just do this. Huh? If you have small collections, which always, where you know it only contains 3 elements, maybe it's better to write this code instead of a for loop because it's easier to read. And the compiler, if it's clever, will create some code like this. If it's not clever, it will create a loop, and then you get problems with modern CPUs because all these jumps in there, there's the jump prediction that doesn't work fine and so on. This code runs way faster if the compiler is not clever. Yeah. And just here, this is C. Does anybody know what this does? Yeah, string copy. So I think nobody began with C here from you, because this is a very typical idiom. Everybody who writes C should have seen this. It just copies a string to another string. Hopefully it's zero terminated. So what to say? Mixed emotions. I've got a mixed feeling about clever programming. It always looks good, and when Swift evolved some years ago, you could see many blogs where the people did many clever things with functional programming and so on, which unfortunately didn't work with Swift 2 and Swift 3 anymore, because it was way too clever, or the language just evolved in a way they didn't foresee. So if you try to be too clever, maybe your code won't work anymore anyhow in some future. Hopefully it will, but yeah, you might get problems. And I only can wish to everyone to just stay small. Don't join large-scale projects. Yeah? I do this large scaling I do about 80 or 90% of the time. The rest of the time I do some Swift stuff for friends of mine who run their own companies. I try to help them. And this is just holidays for me. Yeah, small project where you can have an overlook of everything. There's no configuration and so on. So that's it. I don't know, way too fast. Any questions?